Hi, my name is Dr. Henning Cummings, and today I'll be talking to you about teaching aquaponics at Tarleton State University. So we're looking at lettuce growing in towers and rafts, beaver boards, 2-inch net ponds. We're going to talk about prawns. We're going to talk about these filters. We're going to talk about tilapia and shading the tank. We're going to talk about breeding tilapia. We're selecting for a silver colored tilapia that we can see in our iron stained, cocoa coir stained water. We're going to talk about that solid lifting overflow. And we're going to talk about breeding fish. We also breed the natural camouflaged fish for people to release in their farm tanks to control vegetation and give food for the bass in the tank as well. And one reason that we're talking about these prawn is because we can reduce the discharge of fish feces to the environment. So towers, rafts. So lots of times to talk about STEM in this talk. We'll talk about fish tanks, aeration, breeding tanks, media, rafts, filtration of solids, seedlings, solid waste disposal, prawn, Mexican scud, cocoa coir and food storage, backup generator, pest control, fish capture, fillet, cook. We'll talk about the wicking bed and protein supplements like black soldier fly, larvae, and azolla. So first we'll talk about the filtration system. 80% of the flow goes to the biofilter to pull out ammonia, and 20% of the flow goes to the fish solid removing filters. We reduce the flow to allow settling. We want at least 20 minutes retention time. Ooh, want to oversize all our pipes. They'll get smaller with age. So the solid lifting overflow allows us to have a standpipe, and that prevents accidental draining of the fish tank. But we need to get solids off the bottom of the tank. So we put a shroud over the standpipe and bubble large bubbles, and that creates a current that can lift solids off the bottom and get them in the standpipe where we can get them into the filter. Having a standpipe makes it a little bit more difficult to lower the water to harvest all of the fish, so we use a temporary tank. So here's the shroud going over the standpipe. So the next stop is the screen to pull out scales and snails. And then this is a screen that pulls out the largest fish solids, and then we backwash it to the prawn tank. We split the flow above that, and 20% goes to the solid removing filters and 80% goes to the biofilter. So when we backwash to the prawn tank, we'll bubble a lot of air in there since we're pumping solid waste into this tank for the prawn to eat. And then in order to give each prawn about 2 square feet without increasing the footprint of the tank, we put these structures in there. So in the biofilter, there's lots of surface area, and we convert the ammonium to nitrate using surface area of these bio balls. And then we relate it back to something the students already know. So here's the bio ball we didn't like because they can lock together and block a 2-inch pipe. You'll need to have some type of containment system so the balls stay in the vessel. So the next stop is the swirl filter, where we swirl water on the sides and the solids fall out, and then we can remove the solids. And they'll leave in the top center where the current is still. So here we're putting the water on the side to get the swirl, and we have a collar over the exit pipe so solids can't leave this vessel. Solids might be able to leave this vessel because they could settle, but then through microbial action, rising CO2 bubbles like champagne bubbles can lift the solids back up to the surface. So you have to drain this tank regularly to keep the solids in there. And then we feed the heterotrophic bacteria with sugar to break it down so we can use it as a potted plant fertilizer. You can put a red-eared shellcracker or tilapia in here, but to get snails and eggs and baby fish, but you don't want any breeding happening in here. We don't want any tilapia going to the lettuce where they could eat the roots. So we're going to install the swirl filter. We're going to build a foundation teaching students how to measure, cut, and connect and mix concrete. Always want to have the vessel with lots of water in it before you cut it so you know how it's going to stand when it is weighted with water. And then we went under the sidewalk and pulled it back out. And now we'll talk about the 20% flow that goes to the solid removing filters, the clarifier, that anaerobic mineralization tank. Now, it doesn't really get anaerobic. We're not really degassing hydrogen sulfide or methane, but we're really oxygenating the water before it goes to the plants. So this is an outdoor system, but we're going to split the flow, slow down the flow through the solid removing systems, and most of the flow will go to the biofilter and back to the fish tank. So students learn to measure volume. They learn to measure flow rate using the scale to measure volumes of water and how much we caught in a minute. And then with the volume of the filter, we can calculate retention time. So we just want the solids to fall out by slowing the water down. We want to pull the fish eggs and baby fish out so they don't go to the rafts. Then gravity takes it from the swirl filter to the clarifier. So in the anaerobic mineralization tank, there's lots of this netting. So when it's time to clean it, we'll turn the water off and let things settle. We'll lower some of the water and get some of those solids. And then we'll clean off the netting and let that solid settle, and then we'll get them out of that cylinder. So we want the netting to take up the whole volume of the cylinder and not bunch near the top. So this is the normal position of this pipe, but when we're cleaning filters, we can reorient the pipe and close this valve, and any solids that we dislodge but don't remove don't go back, don't go to the plants, but rather just go back to the fish tank where we have another chance to pull those solids out. So we're getting the solids out of the bottom of the fish tank, and we're seeing that CO2 overnight lifts a semi-solid up to the top of the 5-gallon bucket. So we're going to put it in an aeration barrel that's vigorously aerated. And here goes that semi-solid off the top. We'll let it settle again. We'll pour the dissolved nutrients in the swirl filter, and then we'll take the solids off the bottom and put them in this aeration vessel. And then we'll add sugar so the heterotrophic bacteria can break it down so we can put it in a container and sell it as a potted plant fertilizer. We don't want any CO2 generation in here to make the bottle swell or to make the content smell. There's no smell and there's no weed seeds. We don't want it to be mostly liquid, so we'll turn the water aeration off and pump off the water off the top. If it doesn't settle, it's not ready to go into the bottle. And now the dissolved nutrients are back in the system for the plants. So we're putting the composted fish feces in a cucumber pot, and we're seeing how the roots concentrate in the fish feces to show people it's a great potted plant fertilizer. And then we don't have a discharge to the environment. It's a real sustainable fertilizer. And then the water goes back to the sumps and back to the fish tanks. So we had a snail problem, and we're investigating Mexican scud to remove the snails, maybe by competing with food and maybe by eating the snail eggs. So we've showed you what the students can do in a greenhouse, but they don't have a greenhouse. But when you show them this stacked IBC system where the gravel is the filter for the fish and it floods and drains and they can grow everything but root crops in here, they're like, wow. They love that autosiphon. This is the gateway drug to aquaponics right there. So we said we can't grow the rooting crops in the flooding drains. This is how we grow them. We grow it in a wicking bed. We'll put our composted fish feces in here and plant our root crops, and that way they grow down to the feces and the water wicks up, and we don't eat something that was submerged in an animal waste. So students learn to solve problems. They learn to measure, cut, and connect and work together. So this is what we've been talking about. And this is what we're going to talk about: aeration, breeding, and using prawn and Mexican scud to scavenge fish solids. So we're wanting to move large quantities of air, not really put air under pressure. You need a little bit of pressure to get it 6 feet under. We want to mount these air pumps above the fish tank. So if air flow stops, we don't want to create a siphon where we can drain our tanks. You need to be able to restore air pressure within 30 minutes. So you need to be notified, and you need to connect to a generator within 30 minutes or your fish will suffocate. Need to have a place to isolate new fish and isolate them and add some salt to that water. It's probably better to set up a brood tank so you can breed your own fish. So set up a buck and doe, and the blunt end of this needle will go further into the female. So if you're having trouble getting a buck and doe paired, maybe add more food more regularly, and that might stop some of the bullying. Once you have a successful brood, get the buck and doe out of there because they could reduce your brood population. One way to separate fish is to get a laundry basket and some PVC to help it float and give it some freeboard so the fish can't jump out. And then you can put the babies in a special container. Or you can put the babies in an aquarium, but make sure you have a filter that's not going to suck them into the filter and keep your aquariums out of the sunlight. So when it's time to drain the tanks to harvest and inventory the fish or clean the lettuce rafts, we use this temporary tank. So you have to be able to pump a lot of water fast. So we make an assumption about how many gallons we're going to give a pound of fish and how big we want our fish to be at harvest. And that tells us how many fish we can have in the tank. So it's not the number of fish you have, it's the pounds of fish you have. But this is the Mexican scud we're talking about. This is what's really reducing the volumes of solids in our system. And we just need to do some research to make sure that they're not going to impact the lettuce roots. We know that prawn can impact lettuce roots, so we put them in an enclosure that keeps them from getting to the roots. So they'll be mean to their neighbor. You have to space them out, and this all thread helps keep them spaced out, and it keeps them on the bottom. So the other research we're doing is comparing beaver boards to 2-inch net pots. So the beaver board, you grow it in the seedling tray and put it right in the raft so you don't have to worry about cleaning net pots. So maybe we would use less coquoquar in that situation. Maybe we would colonize the coquoquar more quickly with the 1-inch pot. And we'll compare both of these in rafts and in towers. The 2-inch pots grow really well in the towers. The 1-inch don't give you much safety if flow stops in your tower because of a clog or an electrical outlet. Once we had flow stop to the rafts, but our towers drained outside the rafts, so we drained them a little bit. So we'll talk a little bit about pest control, and that's going to be about prevention and exclusion. We've talked a little bit about the fish tanks, just have to cover it so a bird, they don't feel like a bird's going to swoop down and get them, and we don't want fish to jump out. And then you'll need a place to store food, store coquoquar, and a place to germinate seedlings. So prevent by sanitation, keep it clean, don't spill food, don't store your nets where a rat might move through it, get a hole in it. Students love the ladybug release. They just can't get enough of it. Ladybugs might not last as long in the greenhouse as green lacewings, but what you're wanting is their aphid. That soft body can swell with all of the insects they eat. So we use the yellow sticky cards. We use netting. We use this bug zapper to get the cabbage worm moth, but we just want it to come on at night so it's on a timer. And citronella just loves aquaponics water. Hey, Mom. Hey, Laura. Ooh, don't want this shovel head. They'll eat earthworms. Get rid of those. So in academia, you want to spend the budget all at once so they can't take it back from you. So sorry, you can't buy fish food. So buy it and be able to store it. Keep your seeds in a refrigerator. So we'll need a place to start your seeds. We need to teach students how to fillet and cook. It might be the first time they've ever euthanized a fish. And then we'll talk about some composting fish feces. So students teach me how their family fillets, and I teach them how to fillet. It might be the first time a student's ever filleted a fish, cooked a meal from scratch. So we use a simple skillet that they can have, and we learn to cook. We learn about sanitation. And we go and gather the ingredients, and then we make a salad. And I love for them to eat a salad without any salad dressing, using some flavored seeds and breads as well. Need to have a generator, need to be able to connect it within 30 minutes. We're gonna talk about black soldier fly larvae and azolla as protein supplements. And then, hey, label your system so people can take a self-guided tour. So we're learning to fillet fish, so we're not the best at getting all the meat off of them, so we can recover some of this protein by feeding it to black soldier fly larvae. Look at the bones! And then they'll self-harvest into this container, and then they'll self-harvest again into the juvenile tank where these fish need more protein. So we'll also grow azolla as a vegetable plant-based protein, and this is a legume, so it takes atmospheric nitrogen and puts it in a form that plants can use. So it didn't take any chemical nitrogen to make this azolla. This came out of the atmosphere, so it's a real sustainable fish food. So thank you for your time and attention. My name is Dr. Henning Cummings.